Hello, and welcome to the World Server module brought to you by CJR Gaming. My name is Christian Richards, and in the last episode, we took a look at the information we needed in order to register our region server to our world server. In this episode, we're going to take a look at the couple of handlers that we need in order to ensure that our messages go from the client through the world server over to the region server, and then from the region server back through the world server and out to the proxy server so it can go back to the client or clients that need to receive those messages. Essentially, these couple of handlers that we're going to be creating are going to make the world server basically transparent. Now, one of the nice things about this is that we'll also be going into our complex servers connection collection, and we'll only have the one world server being registered rather than a whole bunch of region servers that we then have to try and figure out how we're going to get that data passed to the region servers. So let's go ahead and open up Visual Studio. And we'll begin just by creating one of the three handlers. This first handler is actually going to be a default handler that is going to take our client requests and pass them on from the world server to the region server. So I'm just going to create this new class. And I'm going to call this new class Client Region Request Forward Handler. That way we actually get an understanding that that's really what it is. So it's coming from the client, so I call it client. It's going to the region server. It's a request. And then this one happens to be a forward handler. And once that new file gets created, we'll go ahead and start filling it out. Now, as I said, this is going to be one of our default request handlers, and so we are going to have to register it here in the world server, simply because while we could register it as a photon server handler, we want this to happen to every single request that comes to our server. And of course, we'll have exceptions to those rules, as we have had in the past, such as on the proxy server, before it forwards stuff back to the client, we modify the packet and send it back to the client. We'll have something similar here in this video as well. So this is going to be a default request handler. And that comes from MMO Photon server. And then I'm going to go ahead and generate a constructor, which is just going to take a Photon application, which is fine. We're just passing that back down to our base class. No need to do anything there. And then we'll implement the members for this. And go ahead and implement all four because we need all four of them done. So this first one, I'm going to return message type dot request, because this is a request that's coming in and we're going to forward it along. My code is going to return the byte cast of client operation code dot region, because these are going to the region server. Essentially, that's how we're going to mask it. Our client isn't going to change. It's just going to say this message needs to go to the region server, and it will pass through the world server for us automatically. The client won't even know that there is a world server, but that is where some of our functionality is going to go. Our subcode is just going to return null. No need to do anything there. And then we're going to begin with our onHandle message. We're going to begin handling our message with just a log.debug format, and I like to just put in here we are forwarding a client message to the region server. Now we can yank that out at a later date, but this is in here so that we can ensure that we are forwarding this message to the client, or at least reaching this log debug format first. Next, I'm going to do a var operation request. And I'm going to set that equal to a new operation request. And I'm going to create it passing in a message.code and the message.parameters. Next, I'm going to do another log.debugformat. And this is like some of the other ones that we've had in here. I'm going to say in here, looking for peer ID 0. And then I'm going to do a new GUID coming from that byte array of message.parameters sub byte client parameter code dot peer ID. And then that needs to just go to GUID, capital G, lowercase UID. And that way I'm just making sure that it's looking for the correct peer ID. Next, I'm going to create a subserver client. A subserver client peer. So subserver client peer. Now the reason I'm creating it instead of doing a var is because the next thing I need to do is I need to say server.connectionCollection sub world server connection collection dot clients dot, and then I need to do a try get value. And then I'm going to take this same, actually, I'm going to take this new GUID out real quick. I'm going to X this out, or cut it, sorry. And then I'm going to say var peer GUID, or just rather peer ID equals, and then paste that back in. And then we'll just take and pass in the peer ID here. We have that peer, and then we're going to try get value on the peer ID and send out that peer. Rather than trying to convert it to a GUID twice after casting it to a byte array, we're just going to save ourselves a few cycles, a little bit of memory there, and just do it this way. Next, I'm going to say if peer does not equal null, then what I want to do is I want to do peer.clientData world server client data, which we created in the last video, dot region server so that we actually get the region server out from there, and then I'm going to do a send operation request. Now, you might be sitting here thinking, well, why are we creating a new operation request? Well, part of the way we have our handlers set up is we don't normally create new operation requests. We usually create a type of iMessage that happens to have that data along with it. And so that's why we have to create a new operation request, because Photon doesn't know how to handle an iMessage. It knows how to handle operation requests, events and operation responses. So, in case you were wondering, that is why we have to do that new creation there. And then I'm just going to send along with it a set of new send parameters. So that's everything we needed for our client region request forward handler. All it's going to do is it's going to take the message, it's going to look for the correct peer ID, and it's just going to send it right along. What's happening is we have this region server that's being set up. So when the client logs in, the client is assigned a region server based on their position in the world. Again, that's why we created the region info with the region info operation, and we have that server area handler so that we know where the client is in terms of which region server it is connected to. We won't be covering that with this series, but in a later series, we will be covering how to switch the client from one region server to another, along with the code that has to go along with that, so that one server can successfully pass a client over to a different server and we can go across seamless bounds without causing any issues. It's basically the same code you'd see even if we had independent zones. It's just that it works both for independent zones and for things like our seamless world. They both handle the code basically the same way. With that handler done, we'll go ahead and create the other two handlers here before we go back into the world server and get them defined as the default handlers. So the next one I'm going to cover is I'm going to call this one region server event forward handler. Now, the reason I'm calling it this is because the idea is the client will only ever send requests. There's a possibility that another server may send a request through the world server, and we have to set up a special handler for that. And this is the exact opposite direction. When a region server creates an event and passes it back, our default is just going to be to send that back to the server that created it. Back to the proxy server in order to get it back to the client. So our default is when we receive events, when we receive requests, they're just going to get shot right back to the proxy server so it can keep going to the client it needs to go to. So this one here is our default event handler. And I'm just going to go ahead and generate a constructor because we don't do anything with that, and then implement the members. My message type is going to return message type.async because we are doing the asynchronous. My code over here, again, these are going to appear like they're coming from the region server. So I am going to return the bytecast of client operation code.region, just like that. My subcode, again, because these are default handlers, we're not worried about any particular subhandler, so we're just going to return null. And then in our onHandle message, we're going to do almost the exact same thing that we did before. Instead, because this is an event going back, I'm just going to say first if message.parameters.containsKey, and it needs to have a byte key of client parameter code.peerID. Then we'll go ahead and do everything. Otherwise, we're just going to return true at the end and act like we never did anything with this. So we're going to say, yeah, we handled it, but because it wasn't going back to a specific peer, it's not going to go anywhere. The server is basically just going to eat that message. As we did before, I need a subserver client peer that I'm just going to call peer. And then I'm going to say server.connectionCollection, world server connection collection, dot clients, dot try-get value. And we're going to get that same code that we had before. So I'm just going to paste in that GUID there and then say out peer. Now, we're only using this once. That's why I'm just grabbing it here rather than setting it to a new value. And then I'm just going to say if peer does not equal null, then I'm just going to say peer.clientData world server client data, pull in that reference, dot proxy server rather than the region server, dot send event, and I'm going to pass it a new event data with the message dot code and the message dot parameters and a new send parameters. So just like that, I'm just going to go ahead and send that on back to our client, or to our proxy, so that it can continue back to the client. I'm going to create that last default handler, which is going to then be our region server response forward handler, just like that. And I'm going to say public class, come over here and do a, again, it's a default, only this time it's a response handler. Generate the constructor for that, and then go ahead and implement these members. My message type is going to be to return a message type.response. The code I'm going to pass in is going to return the bytecast of client operation code.region. My subcode, again, because this is going to be for everything, is just going to be return null. And then our onHandle message. Now, some of this is going to look a little similar, and then some of it is going to look a little bit different. Now, if you recall from the proxy server's response forward handler, when it goes to the client, we have to double check and make sure that this is, that our response has is an actual Photon response, as opposed to another type of response that doesn't have the debug message or the return code. Because if something changes later on down the line and we no longer have a Photon response coming in, then we won't have that debug message and that return code, and so we send it a different way. Because those debug messages and return codes go into the operation response through a parameterized constructor as opposed to passing it through the regular constructor. So I'm going to begin with if message dot parameters dot contains key, and just like we did before, I'm going to take the bytecast of the client parameter code dot peer ID and make sure I have one of those before I even begin. If I don't have that, it just immediately jumps down, returns true. We just eat that message. Next, I'm going to go ahead and do a log.debug format, and I'm going to say, as before, looking for peer ID 0 and passing in a new GUID, which has a byte array of message.parameters, and I'm going to take a byte cast of the client parameter code.peerID. Now, because we're doing this in a message, again, as I did before, I am actually going to cut that part out. I'm going to say var peerID is equal to that, so that I can just log the peer ID. And then I'm going to do some of the same code that you've seen me do before. So again, sub server client peer. And then server.connection collection, world server connection collection, dot clients, dot try get value. And here's where we are going to pass in that peer ID. And then we are also going to pass in out peer so that we get our peer back out from there. After that, I'm going to say if peer does not equal null, then here we go. Just do a log.debug format found peer so that we do know that we found the peer. Var response equals message as photon response, and then if response does not equal null, then what we'll do is we'll say peer.clientData world server client data dot proxy server. Dot send operation response, And we're going to pass in a new operation response with the response.code, the response.parameters, and then again, I was talking about those parameterized, that parameterized constructor. We're going to pass in the debug message equal to the response.debug message, and my return code is the response.return code, just like that. And then from there, I'm also going to pass in a new set of send parameters, and then go ahead and finish that off there. Now, if this isn't a response, then I'm just going to do a simple peer.clientData that, oops, the world server client data dot proxy server dot send operation response. And I'm just going to pass in a new operation response that is just a message.code, message.parameters, and a new send parameters. There we go. Now we've got all three of our default handlers set up and ready to go. Now you're probably sitting there thinking that, okay, it's got the last word of handler in here, and so we don't have to do anything because, well, we've got it looking for everything that's a handler and registering it as a Photon server handler. The only problem with that is that these are our default handlers, which have to be registered separately. So here in the region server, I'm just going to add those in real quick right here underneath the handle server registration. And I'm just going to say builder.registerType, pass in the client region request forward handler. And I'm going to say dot as default, and this is going to be my my default request handler here, dot single instance, since we only ever need one of these. And now it's saying that it cannot resolve. There we go. Helps if I type the name in completely correctly. So I'm just going to take this real quick, I'm going to copy it, and I'm going to paste it in two more times. The second one is going to be a region, the region server event forward handler, which is then the default event handler. And then the region server response forward handler, which is our default response handler. So that's everything that we need at the moment in order to get messages to and from the world server. But there are a few more handlers that we do need to create before we can call this project done. The first two are when we get a client, registering and deregistering that client. So when they connect, how we determine which one is their region server and go through that process. Deregistering is to, you know, basically log them out of the world server. And then another one is that when the user actually logs out, we have an event handler for handling that as well, because we do have an event that gets sent out from the server when a user logs out. So if we take a look at our chat server real quick, we've got our register event, our deregister event, and I might be getting ahead of myself here, sorry. It looks like I'm getting ahead of myself. That is for another event. One of the things I was prototyping out was the ability to have the client log out after they have actually logged out. So you know how most MMOs, they have a timer that's like 10 seconds or so after that you have to wait before you can log out. EVE Online has something similar where if you crash to desktop or whatever, you go to a safe spot after a certain amount of time. And that's the idea behind this other event that I was thinking I had already implemented, but we will have to save that handler for another time. So that's a bit of a teaser. We'll only be working with two other handlers here, which are the world server register event handler and the world server deregister event handler, so that when a character is selected and they're logging into the world server can keep track of them. So we'll begin with, let's actually begin with the deregister event because it is really simple. I'm going to just call this world server deregister event handler. Make that a public class. It's going to just be our typical Photon server handler rather than anything special. Give it a constructor. Go ahead and implement the members. We're going to return that it's a message type.async. We are going to return the bytecast of server event code dot character deregister, just like that. Our subcode is just going to return null since there's only the one type. And then we have our onHandle message. Now the onHandle message is pretty easy. I'm just going to create a GUID called peerID, set that equal to a new GUID, which is the capital byte array cast of message.parameters sub byte. Client parameter code dot peer ID. Then all I'm going to do is I'm going to say var clients equals server.connectionCollection world server connection collection dot clients, and then just do a clients sub peer ID dot client data, and then I need that world server client data dot region server dot send event new event data, and then message dot code message dot parameters, and then a new send parameters. Now this is what I was talking about earlier, where we have an event that is going to be coming from the proxy server, and if we didn't create this right here, what would happen is the deregister event would get sent to the world server, and the world server would just send it back to the proxy server, and it wouldn't do us any good at all to just, you know, have that message go and not do anything. And so this is why we have these type of the specialized handlers that says, okay, this is an event. I know it's going to be coming from the proxy server. I now need to pass that to the region server so that the region server still logs them out the way we did initially. And then the last thing I need to do is just return true to say that I handled that message. Now, this is a handler. It is a Photon server handler, and so we don't need to go into the world server in order to add that. The same will be true of the other class that we will be adding, which is the opposite of this direction, which is world server register event handler. Again, it's going to be a public class. It's going to be of type Photon server handler. We're going to generate a constructor. We're going to implement the members. And now this one is going to take just a little bit longer because here, first we're going to return that it is another event. Again, handling events so that it doesn't just get forwarded back to the proxy server and not go anywhere. return the byte cast of the server event code. Dot character register this time. And then here, return null. Then in my onHandle message, this is where we now have to go in, take a look at the database, figure out where the character is, and then figure out what region server the character should be assigned to. So here we go. I'm going to start with a try. And it's got a catch down at the end, just in case. All I'm going to do in that case is I'm just going to log the error of E, and down here I'm just going to log that error E. Otherwise, I'm going to return true. All right, so I have that going on. So now I'm going to set it up like I would any other time I am talking to the database. I'm going to start with a using var session equals in hibernate helper dot open session. And it wants that reference, so I'm going to go ahead and add that reference. There we go. And then I'm going to be using var transaction. Set that equal to session.beginTransaction. And then I'm going to go ahead and get the character. So I'm going to say that var character equals session.queryOver, and I want a complex character as opposed to a simple character, right? Dot where that character has an ID that equals the character ID. Oh, and that's some stuff I need to put up above this here. That'll give me an error for right now. And then I'm just going to say dot single or default. Now, I used to be I would do a dot list and then a dot first or default. It turns out that dot single or default combines both of those into one thing, and I don't have to worry about it as much. It makes it for just a little bit simpler rather than creating a list in memory and then turning that list into just getting the first item in there or returning null. Now I need that character ID, so I'm going to say int character ID equals convert dot to int 32 message dot parameters the byte cast of client parameter code dot, oops, and then I want the character ID. Now I'm also going to go ahead and get the peer ID and set that equal to a new GUID, which is of course the byte array cast of message dot parameters sub byte cast of client parameter code dot peer ID, just like that. So now I've got the character ID, so I've got a character, or I should have a character. Next I'll say if character does not equal null, not character ID, just character, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off with just doing a transaction.commit, because I don't need the transaction anymore. I'm not going to do anything. If I accidentally change data, I can't commit it anymore. So I'm just kind of done with the transaction. I'm not going to do anything else with the database. Next, I'm going to say var clients is equal to server.connectionCollection, world server connection collection dot clients. And then I'm just going to say clients.add. And then I want to add in that peer ID along with the client factory with the peer ID. So First off, we need that client factory. We'll get to that in just a moment. Next, I'm going to say var server equals server.connectionCollection, world server connection collection dot, and I'm going to do a get server by type, passing in the int cast of the server type dot region. And as you remember, we also need to pass in this character's position. So I also want to pass in character dot position. Now, right now that's just a string, and that's not good because it's actually expecting a position. So for right now, I'm going to put in here, this will be for a future thing because right now we're still running with just one region server. I'm going to say deserialize character dot position. And then I'm going to do new position, passing in 000. And then I am going to put in a slash slash and do character dot position. Well, actually, this will probably just be position, close paren, semicolon, and then I'm going to put a nice big to-do in there so that it shows up as blue as something that I need to do at a later date, because we aren't going to cover that right this minute. You guys should already know how to deserialize XML in order to get the position back out, and then take that position and feed it through to this get server by type. Next, I'm going to say server.sendEvent, new event data, message.code, message.parameters, and say new send parameters. So I've just sent the server, meaning the region server, an event to say, hey, this character needs to log in. But now I need to make sure that my client with the peer ID has his client data for that world server client data. And I need to make sure that the region server for him is set equal to server. And I need to say that the same client with the client data, I need the world server client data for the proxy server to be set equal to the server peer. So just like that, we have all of that. Now, I have in here this client factory, and we still need to deal with it. How I deal with it is that in the constructor, because we are working with AutoFact, all I have to do is I have to say sub server client peer dot factory, and then call that client factory. And then from there, what I can do is I can use resharper. Resharper should actually come over here and tell me that I can introduce an initialized field client factory, which is the same thing as what I've got down there. I've got client underscore client factory equals client factory. Up here, I've got a private read-only subserver client peer factory that's called client factory, and then the red mark for this server is gone. Now, again, these are both handlers, so we don't have to add them to our world server, but all this is doing is this one, when a character logs in, it's figuring out what region server it's supposed to go to. In this case, right now, it's just grabbing whatever one is at the origin. And then from there, it's setting up the rest of the client data. And then in our deregister, that's where we go ahead and just pass along that event so that the region server can let go of that character. So that's everything that we need to do in order to get our world server caught up. I apologize for teasing you guys a little bit with the logout handler that I've written in my prototype code. I should cover that in the near future. The next video will actually be covering the upgrade to Photon 3.4 as we start to move on towards our AI. I look forward to it. I hope you guys do too.